Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the day 21st of April 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis and their respective page numbers of the Chennai, Bengaluru, Thiruvananthapuram and Delhi editions. The link for the handwritten notes is given in PDF format in the description section given below and also in the comment section. Let us now move on to the discussion of news articles of the day. The first news article of the day is India rice rate dip as demand slows, Vietnam prices flat. This news article appears in page number 11 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Trivandrum editions and in page 13 of your Delhi edition. The content of this news article and our analysis will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and next under economic development in particular. Also, it would be helpful for your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 3 under major crops, cropping patterns, transport and marketing of the agricultural produce and issues and related constraints in particular. Let us now start with our analysis. This news article lists down some of the rate statistics and the low demand for rice as a reason for the decrease of the prices of the Indian rice commodity. Let us not focus on the rates. We shall see more about the reasons for the price dip and also some facts about the rice crops in particular. There are three main reasons for the low demand of Indian rice that has resulted in its price decrease mentioned in this news article. The first reason is the weak demand from the African countries who happen to be the major importer of Indian rice. Since their inventory is ample, there is a weak demand. Inventory is nothing but the stock or quantity of a particular good. Ample inventory mentioned in the news article means excess stock availability. The second reason for the price dip is the aggressive selling of old inventories by China at lower prices. This is a significant influence that has caused the price dip. The third reason mentioned in the news article is the decrease in the purchase by Bangladesh country. In 2017, Bangladesh was facing a rice shortage. India's rice exports made Bangladesh avert this shortage. But in the previous year, a bumper production of rice has been achieved by Bangladesh. So this has also resulted in the price dip because of a low demand. India's rice exports have stood at 10.57 million tons in the year 2018-19, which is 9.4% lesser than that of the exports made in the year 2017-18 if you see. As already told, do not focus on the price numbers mentioned in the news article. Let us now see some facts about rice crop in India. The scientific name of rice is Oryza sativa. Rice is grown throughout the length and breadth of India in widely varying zones and also the altitude. The best suited climate for rice is the hot and humid climate. Rice grown in altitudes from 0 meters, that is the mean sea level, and also up to about 3000 meters. Rice is also grown at below mean sea level altitudes in India. The only one such case in India in the Kuttanad region of Kerala. The ambient temperatures for cultivating rice vary from region to region and also based on altitudes. The average temperature required for growing rice across India is 21 degrees to 37 degrees Celsius if you see. The maximum temperature at which the rice crop grows is from 40 to 42 degrees Celsius. Rice is a rich source of carbohydrates. Hence, it is widely consumed by the entire world population. Rice is a poor source of proteins and fats. Let us now see some important uses of rice crop that includes your entire rice crop, the edible as well as the non-edible portions of the crop. Rice is mainly consumed as a food grain. Many food materials are processed from starch. Alcoholic malt is also manufactured from rice. The rice straws are widely used in the making of porcelain and glass, and they are also used in pottery. The paper pulp is also manufactured with rice crop as one of its main sources. Livestock bedding is traditionally made with the help of dried rice crop, its straws, husk, etc. Now, the public procurement of rice and its further distribution to the citizens is carried out by the Food Corporation of India in India. Rice cultivation is supported in the form of minimum support prices, in short MSP, by the central government. Now, let us see some statistics in relation to rice produced, processed and sold as a food commodity. India is the second largest producer of rice in the world. China stands as the largest producer of rice in the world if you see. India is largest exporter of rice in the world. India accounts for 30.1% of total rice exports. Let us now see some of the factors that influence the prices of rice commodity. The first factor is the carryover stocks. These carryover stocks are nothing but the leftover stocks from the previous year's production after meeting the demand. The second factor is the expected demand.
which is nothing but the average level of consumption and exports during the past few years. The demand-supply cycle should be a consistent one for a better price realization. The third factor is the crop acreage, which means extent of area sown under the crop. If the crop acreage is more, the production is more likely to be more, so the supply side can be satisfied. The next factor is the production quantities. It is the estimated output of the rice crop, but it is based on various parameters such as your acreage, weather conditions, pest infestations, etc. The next factor is imports and exports. The government has thoroughly controlled rice trade as it is a major food grain crop in India. So, the price factor is largely controlled by the government. The next and the most important factor is the government policies. It includes any change in government policy relating to the crop such as your MSP, which is the minimum support price, that would determine the prices of the rice. The final factor is procurement factor. The direct procurement by the government agencies and storage in warehouses that primarily includes the Food Corporation of India that we saw a short while ago, and change in tariff and base prices of externally traded goods will have a direct impact on the respective commodity prices. These are some of the major and the most common factors that consistently influence the prices of rice commodity. Let us now see some of the recent current affairs news from the past few months in relation to the food grain rice. The first news is the inauguration of International Rice Research Institute, South Asia Regional Center, called IRRI-SARC in short. This institute was inaugurated in the city of Varanasi in India. It would focus on the research activities of developing new varieties of rice. Its headquarters is based at Las Banos, Baguna in the country of Philippines. The next current affairs news that you need to follow is if any geographical indication tag, shortly called the GI tag, is awarded to any of the rice varieties. In the financial year 2018-19, two types of rice have been awarded the GI tag status. First one is the Boko Chawal rice variety from the state of Assam, and next one is the Jiraful rice, an aromatic rice variety of Chhattisgarh state. In the last financial year, three rice varieties have been given GI tag. They are the Katarni rice from Bihar state, Tulapanji rice, and Gobind Bog rice varieties from the state of West Bengal. With this, we come to the end of this topic analysis. Now, from prelims perspective, try to know about the cultivation parameters discussed, the uses of rice crop, about IRRI-SARC, and finally about the GI tags recently awarded to some rice varieties. Try to know about the factors affecting rice prices for your mains preparation. You can also use the statistics relevantly as per the question requirements in your General Studies 3 paper. Now, have a look at the prelims question, which I'll discuss at the end of the session. Let us move on to the next news article. The second news article of the day is Indoor Emissions Affect Air Quality Standards. This news article appears in page number 13 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Trivandrum editions and in page number 15 of your Delhi edition. The contents of this news article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and general issues on environmental ecology in particular. Also, it would be helpful for your mains preparation in General Studies paper 3 under environmental pollution and degradation in particular. Let us now start with our analysis. A recent study was conducted by researchers from the Indian Institute of Technology, IIT Delhi, in collaboration with University of California from USA, Urban Emissions based out of Delhi, and University of Illinois from USA. Here, note that Urban Emissions is an NGO platform having a repository of information, research and analysis related to air pollution. In the study, the researchers have found that 40% of the total particulate matter 2.5 recorded in Gangetic Basin is because of the use of firewood, kerosene and coal in the households. In other words, 40% of the PM2.5 air pollution is because of the indoor air pollution in households. It means that indoor air pollution that happens in the households is a major contributor to the outdoor air pollution in the Gangetic Basin. Particulate matter 2.5 is given importance because it leads to adverse health impacts predominantly affecting the respiratory and cardiovascular systems, and the urban population are the most affected here. Right now, around 40% of Indian population is living in urban areas, and it is estimated that 50% of India's population will live in urban areas by the year 2030, Therefore, reducing particulate matter 2.5 air pollution is of utmost importance. Some of the important findings of the study are that the household pollution significantly contributes to outdoor air pollution, and by eliminating the indoor air pollution and emissions, the average outdoor air pollution level could be brought down within the limits of national ambient air quality standards, in short called as NAAQS. And we already know that the indoor air pollution accounts for nearly 10 lakh deaths in a year in India. In 2017, the average annual PM2.5 air pollution concentration is 125 microgram per meter cube in India. The PM2.5 average annual concentration guideline or standard of the World Health Organization is 10 microgram per meter cube. The WHO air quality guidelines of 2005 prescribe 3 interim targets. The interim target number 1 for PM2.5 annual mean concentrations given by WHO is 35 microgram per meter cube. Interim targets were given in WHO guidelines in 2005 itself. So, why are these interim or temporary targets needed? See, these targets are proposed as incremental steps in a progressive reduction of air pollution. They are mainly intended for use in areas where the pollution is high. These targets aim to promote a shift from high air pollutant concentrations, which have acute and serious health consequences, to lower air pollutant concentrations. If these targets were to be achieved, one could expect significant reductions in risk for acute and chronic health effects from air pollution. Also, if all households move to clean fuels such as liquefied petroleum gas, about 13% of premature mortality or premature deaths in India could be prevented. The study found that if indoor or household air pollution is eliminated, then India's average annual PM2.5 air pollution could drop to 38 microgram per cubic meter, which is within the National Ambient Air Quality Standards prescription of 40 microgram per meter cube as mentioned here. This news article makes a special note about Delhi National Capital Region, in short Delhi NCR. In a departure to previous findings, it states that even if indoor air pollution is mitigated in Delhi NCR, the particulate matter 2.5 pollution in the region would not attain the targets, because in Delhi NCR, the major contributors to air pollution are number 1, the stubble burning from the neighboring states that surround Delhi NCR region, number 2, industrial and power plant emissions in and around Delhi NCR, and number 3, brick kilns and vehicular emissions that happen in Delhi NCR. Therefore, it would require more serious and stringent measures to attain these targets in Delhi NCR in order to mitigate the air pollution. Thus, the article concludes saying that India's pollution problem is much bigger than often perceived, and it requires a multi-pronged approach to control emissions from industries, transportation, and power plants. And mitigating air pollution at the household level is the easiest and more practical way for the government to reduce both household pollution and outdoor air pollution at the national level. Let us now move on to the next news article. The third topic of the day is Karbi tribe, which is based on the picture that appears in page number 18 of Chennai edition and in page number 20 of both Delhi and Trivandrum edition. It has not occurred in Bengaluru edition. The content of this topic will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and next under social geography in particular. The picture talks about Karbi people taking out a procession in a festival celebrated in Marigaon district of Assam. In this context, it is important to know about the Karbi tribe from the prelims perspective. Karbis constitute important ethnic group in the hill areas of Assam, and they are mentioned as the Mikirs in the Constitutional Order of Government of India. However, they never call themselves Mikir, but call themselves Karbi and sometimes Arling, which literally means a man. Although at present they are found to inhabit in Karbi Anglong district in Assam, some Karbi inhabited pockets are also found in other places of Assam like the North Kachar Hills, Kamrup, Marigaon, Nagaon and Sonitpur districts. The Karbi Anglong district enjoys autonomy under the provision of 6th schedule of the Indian Constitution. It is the largest district of Assam in terms of area. Kaziranga National Park is part of a larger landscape that extends south into the Karbi Anglong hills. Racially, the Karbis belong to the Mongoloid group, and linguistically they belong to the Tibeto-Burman group. The original home of the various people speaking Tibeto-Burman languages, that also includes a Karbi, was in western China near the Yangtze, Qiang and Huanghuo rivers. Karbis are also mentioned in Buranjis, which is the chronicles written in a prose tradition taken to Assam by the Ahom people. Karbis follow the patriarchal system of family structure. Agriculture is the main occupation of the Karbis. In the hills, they practice juming cultivation. That is the shifting cultivation by cleaning the forest of the hills using slash and burn method. In their gym, they cultivate mixed crops. They also do lowland cultivation where such lands are available. Rongpur and Chomangkan are the two most important festivals of Karbi. Rongker is celebrated the beginning of the new year. It is a springtime festival celebrated by the entire village. Chomangkan is a festival celebrated on the death ceremony of people. It is a non-stop 4 days and four nights celebration. Various types of dances are performed by the youths during the celebration of Rongker and Chomangkan. The Karbi tribe is notified as a scheduled tribe of the state of Assam. These tribes are not listed in particularly vulnerable tribal group designated by the Ministry of Home Affairs. For that matter, no tribe from Assam has been listed in this particularly vulnerable tribal group list. And from the northeastern region of India, only the tribes from the states of Manipur and Tripura are included in this PVTG list. They are Maram Naga tribes from Manipur state and Raying tribes from the state of Tripura. Now have a look at the prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the session. Let us now move on to the next news article. The fourth news article of the day is soon heritage bylaws for Purana Qila, Khair-ul-Manazil. This news article appears in page number 5 of the Delhi edition only. The content of this news article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance in particular. Also, it would be helpful for your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 2 under statutory, regulatory and various quasi-judicial bodies. Let us now start with our analysis. This news article tells that within few days, heritage bylaws for these two monuments would be released by National Monuments Authority, drafted in accordance with the provisions given under Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendment and Validation Act of 2010. These bylaws will determine the nature of the new construction activity in regulated areas. Let us call this act as AMASR Act of 2010 in short. In our discussion, we shall know what is a bylaw, what are prohibited and regulated areas, and about two related institutions, National Monument Authority and Archaeological Survey of India. Let us start with what is meant by a bylaw. It is a rule or law established by an organization or the local communities in order to regulate them. This bylaw will be created as per the provisions given by some higher authority. The higher authority here can be the legislature, which is nothing but the legislative arm of the government, or by a government body, an organization, authority, or an institution of the government. Now, this AMASR Act of 2010 describes about the prohibited areas and regulated areas near the protected national monuments. Prohibited areas are located in 100 meters span from the protected monuments. The area starting from 100 meters from the protected monument till 300 meters away is called the regulated area. Now, Archaeological Survey of India, shortly called ASI, can carry out repairs in this prohibited area. The AMASR Act of 2010 has provided for the bylaws that should be drafted in order to regulate the construction activity in these regulated areas. The National Monuments Authority has been formed as per AMASR Act of 2010 in this context only. Hence, it is a statutory authority. Drafting the bylaws for regulating the construction activities across all the monuments in the country is the main function of this National Monuments Authority. This authority functions under the Ministry of Culture. Let us now see about Archaeological Survey of India, shortly called ASI. It is an attached office under Ministry of Culture. ASI functions as a regulatory body. ASI's main function involves the regulation of all the archaeological activities as per the provisions of the AMASR Act of 1958, that is, Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act of 1958, and also the Antiquities and Art Treasures Act of 1972. The prime function of ASI is the maintenance of ancient monuments, archaeological sites and archaeological remains of national importance. It also involves in exploration and excavation activities of ancient sites. ASI conducts specialized study of inscription and various phases of Indian architecture. ASI also involves in training in different areas of archaeology. Also, ASI involves in the operation of Antiquities and Art Treasures Act of 1972. The headquarters of Archaeological Survey of India is located in New Delhi. Archaeological Survey of India is the successor of the Asiatic Society of India. With this, we come to the end of this topic analysis. Now, from prelims perspective, try to know about the bylaws, prohibited and regulated areas surrounding these protected monuments, and about the two institutions that we saw. National Monument Authority and Archaeological Survey of India. Also, try to know about the functions of Archaeological Survey of India from mains perspective. Now, have a look at the prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the session. Let us now move on to the next news article. The fifth article of the day is Fighting Poverty Through E-commerce. This article appears in page 4 of magazine section in all the 4 editions. The content of this news article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under Economic Development, Sustainable Development, Poverty, Inclusion, and as a part of your mains preparation in your General Studies Paper 3 under the areas Inclusive Growth and Issues Arising from It, and next under Effects of Liberalization on the Economy, and also in your essay paper. Let us start our discussion. E-commerce has grown quickly in China. The total e-commerce trade volume has increased 30-fold in the year 2017 when compared to 2004 levels. While e-commerce is more developed in urban areas of China, online retail sales in rural areas have grown faster than the national average. From 2014 to 17, online retail sales in rural China increased at a compound annual growth rate of 91% compared to 35% nationally. In 2014, the Alibaba Group, in collaboration with the government of China, launched the Rural Taobao program in order to give rural residents a greater access to broad variety of goods and services and help farmers earn more by selling agricultural products directly to urban consumers in online platforms. This program has 4 main activities. The first, setting up of an e-commerce service network in counties and villages. Second, improving logistical connections for villages through 2-stage delivery shipping packages from county centers to villages. Number 3, providing training in e-commerce and promoting entrepreneurship. And finally, number 4, developing rural financial services through one of the subsidiaries of Alibaba Group. The number of Alibaba Taobao villages, which is a cluster of e-retailers, grew from 212 in the year 2014 to 3,202 in the year 2018. The formation of Taobao villages broadly proceeded through these 3 stages. Version 1 was mainly about the grassroots development, where villagers who have distinct entrepreneurial skills led the establishment of online businesses and created models for other villages to follow. As e-commerce developed and more Taobao villages prospered, version 2 was accompanied by government support. The local governments provided direct support for infrastructure, e-commerce training and finance. And then in the version 3, the local governments are providing support through subsidies for specialized e-commerce service providers and firms to build an e-commerce ecosystem with e-platform companies. Success stories in Taobao villages suggest that digital technologies can contribute to inclusive growth in rural China. They can lower the required skill threshold, allowing individuals, including the less educated, to participate in e-commerce and earn more. The experience in Taobao villages has sparked strong interest among researchers, policymakers, and the private sector to explore the use of e-commerce as a tool for poverty alleviation and rural vitalization. The Rural E-commerce Demonstration Program, launched jointly by the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry of Commerce of China in the year 2014, aims to contribute to poverty reduction and the modernization of rural areas through the promotion of e-commerce. Its main activities consist of establishing and improving rural e-commerce public service, fostering rural e-commerce supply chains, promoting connectivity between agriculture and commerce, and enhancing e-commerce training. The program grew quickly, and by the year 2018, it covered 737 poverty-stricken counties, which is 89% of the total, including 137 counties with extreme poverty levels, which is 41% of the total. Many case studies show that strong public-private partnerships can encourage the use of digital technology and e-platforms to support poverty alleviation in rural areas. For example, digital technology improves the quality of agricultural products, and e-platforms expand online markets for agricultural products, create more and better jobs in rural areas. E-commerce has the potential to help support poverty alleviation, but there are certain challenges to it, because developing e-commerce requires much more than connecting people to the internet. It needs proper infrastructure and logistics, entrepreneurship and skills, and a conducive environment, which are all crucial. The key challenge is identifying suitable products for online sales that will have a market. Another challenge is the long-term fiscal sustainability of subsidies to support the participation of the various emerging stakeholders in e-commerce, like the households, individuals, logistic companies, etc. Emerging lessons show that in addition to supporting logistics, providing subsidized training to build human capital, providing subsidized post-training support to help develop the online branding, as well as providing incentives and awards for high-volume online sales can help encourage e-commerce even in areas where the initial endowments are weak. You can utilize this content presented today in your essay writing in special to the e-commerce topic. Let us now move on to the next news article. The final news article of the day is Crab Nebula pictured by Hubble Telescope. This news article appears in page number 13 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Trivandrum editions and in page 15 of your Delhi edition. The content of this news article and our analysis will be helpful in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and next under general science. Let us now start with our analysis. The news article has displayed a picture of the Crab Nebula. In celebration of the 29th anniversary of the launch of NASA's Hubble Space Telescope, astronomers captured a festive, colorful look at the tentacled Southern Crab Nebula. We need to know what is meant by nebula. A nebula is a giant cloud of dust and gas in space, mostly consisting of hydrogen and helium. This Crab Nebula is officially known as HEN-2-104, and it is located several thousand light years from Earth in the southern hemisphere constellation of Centaurus. Centaurus is the closest active galaxy to planet Earth. The nebula, which was pictured, appears to have two nested hourglass shaped structures that were carved by a whirling pair of stars. The duo consists of an aging red giant star and a burned out star and a white dwarf. White dwarfs are stars that have burned up all of the hydrogen which they once used as a nuclear fuel. The bubbles of gas and dust appear brightest at the edges, giving the illusion of crab-like structures. The object was first reported in the late 1960s, but was assumed to be an ordinary star. In 1989, astronomers photographed a roughly crab-shaped extended nebula formed by symmetrical bubbles. Now, from the prelims perspective, it is important to know about the Hubble telescope. The Hubble Space Telescope is a large telescope in space. It was launched in 1990 aboard the space shuttle named Discovery. The Hubble Space Telescope is a project of an international cooperation between NASA and ESA, the European Space Agency. NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland manages the telescope. The Space Telescope Science Institute, located in the city of Baltimore in Maryland, state of USA, conducts the Hubble science operations. Hubble travels around Earth at about 5 miles per second, that is 8 km per second. Hubble faces towards space. Scientists have learned a lot about space from Hubble's pictures. It has beamed hundreds of thousands of images back to Earth, shedding light on many of the greatest mysteries of astronomy. It takes pictures of planets, stars, and galaxies. Hubble has seen stars being born. Hubble has also seen stars die. It has seen galaxies that are trillions of miles away. Its gaze has helped determine the age of the universe to be about 13 to 14 billion years, much more accurate than the old range of anywhere between 10 to 20 billion years. And it determined the existence of dark energy, a mysterious force that causes the expansion of the universe to accelerate. Hubble telescope identified the first supermassive black hole in the heart of a neighboring galaxy, providing evidence of an accelerating universe, which is propelled perhaps by some unknown source of energy in the fabric of space. The Hubble Space Telescope is the direct solution to a problem that telescopes have faced since the very earliest days of their invention, that is the atmosphere. Earth's atmosphere changes and blocks some of the light that comes from space. The shifting air pockets in Earth's atmosphere distort the view of telescopes on the ground, no matter how large or scientifically advanced those telescopes are. This atmospheric distortion is the reason that the stars seem to twinkle when you look up at the sky. Hubble flies around or orbits high above Earth and its atmosphere. So, Hubble can see space better than telescopes on Earth can. All of Hubble's functions are powered by sunlight. Hubble sports solar arrays that convert sunlight directly into electricity. Have a look at the prelims question, we shall discuss at the end of the session. With this, we come to the end of today's discussion. Let us now move on to the practice question discussion session. Question 1. This question asks to match the right pairs of the GI tag varieties with the respective states where the particular rice variety is grown. Let us see the first pair. Katarni rice grows in the state of West Bengal. The first pair is wrong. Katarni rice is grown in the state of Bihar, not West Bengal. Let us see the second pair. Gobindbhog rice grows in the state of Bihar. The second pair is also wrong. It is grown in the state of West Bengal. The first and the second pair are incorrectly matched. The next two pairs are correct. Jeera phool variety is grown in Chhattisgarh and Boko Chawal variety is grown in the state of Assam. So the correct answer here is option B, 3 and 4 only. This question is framed based on the first news article of the day that we have analyzed with respect to the GI tag varieties of various rice. Question 2. The International Rice Research Institute, South Asian Regional Center has recently been launched in which of the following city? Option A, Manila in the country of Philippines. Option B, Dhaka in the country of Bangladesh. Option C, Varanasi in India. And option D, Kandy located in the country of Sri Lanka. This is a very direct question. The answer here is option C, Varanasi, India, as we have seen in our analysis of the first news article. Question 3. Consider the following statements regarding the people of Karbi tribe. Statement 1. They are notified as scheduled tribes of the state of Assam. Statement 2. They practice juming, that is shifting agriculture by slash and burning of land. Statement 3. They are listed as particularly vulnerable tribal group. Here we must choose the correct statement from the above. Considering the first statement, we have already seen that Karbi tribe is notified as scheduled tribes of the state of Assam. Hence, statement 1 is correct. Now, the second statement states that the tribe practices juming, which is also the correct statement. Coming to the third statement, we saw in our discussion that no tribe from the state of Assam has been listed in the particularly vulnerable tribal group. As Karbi is also a tribe from Assam, this statement is wrong. So, the correct option for this question is option A, 1 and 2 only, because statement 3 is wrong. Question 4. Consider the following statements. National Monuments Authority is a statutory authority formed as per the provisions of Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Amendment and Validation Act of 2010. This is the first statement. Second statement, its main function is to regulate the archaeological activities in India. And the statement 3 is it functions under the Ministry of Culture. Here, the first statement is correct. National Monuments Authority is a statutory authority formed as per the provisions of this AMASR Act of 2010. The second statement is wrong. Regulation of archaeological activities in India is done by the Archaeological Survey of India, not the National Monuments Authority. National Monuments Authority's main function is to draft the bylaws for the regulated areas, which we have discussed in our fourth news article of the day. Here, the third statement is correct. Both National Monuments Authority and Archaeological Survey of India comes under the Ministry of Culture. So, option 2 is wrong. Go by the elimination technique here. If 2 is removed, options B and D are out of our focus. Between options A and C, the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Question 5. Consider the following statements with reference to the Hubble Space Telescope. Statement 1. It is a large telescope in space. Statement 2. It is launched by NASA in the year 1990. And statement 3. It identified the first supermassive black hole. Which among the above statements is or correct? We have to look for the correct statements in the above statements as we just saw the question now. From our discussion, we know that Hubble Space Telescope is the large telescope in space, but keep in mind that it is not the largest telescope. Hence, the first statement is correct. The second statement says the telescope is launched by NASA, which is incorrect, as we know from the discussion that it was a joint project of NASA and European Space Agency ESA. But it was launched in the year 1990 only. Hence, the statement here is partially correct because ESA is left out. And the third statement here is correct. We discussed it already in our analysis. So, the correct option for this question is option B, 1 and 3 only, because the statement 2 is wrong. The final practice question. Recently, the image of the Southern Crab Nebula has been captured. Which telescope was used to capture this image? Option A, Event Horizon Telescope. Option B, Spitzer Telescope. Option C, Hubble Space Telescope. And finally, option D, Astrosat. We clearly know from our discussion that the Crab Nebula was captured by NASA. Hence, by the elimination method, option D can be eliminated directly as Astrosat is an Indian telescope launched by ISRO, Indian Space Research Organization. Now, the other three are NASA's telescopes. From this, we have to choose one. With the help of the discussion, we know that the correct answer here is Hubble Space Telescope. Let us now move on to the final question of the day, which is a practice mains question. The question is, examine the role of e-commerce in employment generation in case of rural areas. An answer for this question should include the points mentioned in the article, with or without special reference to China, because this article largely discussed China as a case study. You can simply take points from the analysis of how China achieved the inclusive growth using e-commerce. Also, list out the challenges in e-commerce to substantiate the point that generating employment is not only the primary issue. With this, we come to the end of today's analysis and also today's discussion. Please do like, comment and share the video. And please do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.